future of aerospace, it's all about ideas. I'm sure there's many, many ideas with you in this room today. But what I would like to talk to you about is I have just spent the last 5 days at the Farnborough Airshow. It's the biggest international airshow in the world. And I've come back hugely excited, hugely motivated. I believe I've had a glimpse of what the future looks like. And I'd like to share some of that with yourself. It's quite interesting when you kind of actually go into Farnborough, there's a little bit of looking backwards, the history of it. And even the history of it is really inspiring. 1941, Frank Whittle made his first flight with a jet engine. 1948 was the very first Farnborough Airshow. And a year after that was, in fact, this day, 27th of July, 1949, was the first flight of a Comet jet airliner. That really was the start, the dawn of a new jet age in commercial aerospace. 1970, Concorde made its debut at Farnborough. And I loved that because it was Concorde that drew me into the industry. It really was a magnificent achievement. And if you think about it, the inspiration, the innovation to develop Concorde less than 60 years after the Wright brothers made their very first flight, I sort of sometimes do wonder to myself, why does it take so long to kind of move new ideas forward in the aerospace industry today? And 2006, I was there to watch the A380 made its debut at Farnborough. I had spent 10 years of my life working with and helping to develop and lead the engineering team on the A380. But even though I'd lived 10 years with it, just to see 550 tons of aircraft actually flying and manoeuvring in the sky was just so inspirational. It was just so incredible. So, you know, the history itself, I think, is fascinating. But it left with me that question. So that was the second evolution, the second revolution in aerospace. You know, what is coming next? What is the third revolution of aerospace going to be like? Because there's some real exciting things going on around new materials, new manufacturing processes, new fuels, new digital processes. And so it kind of prompted with me a hypothetical question. What will Farnborough 2030 look like? What will Farnborough 2050 look like? What will Farnborough beyond that look like? And so just to share with you some of my thoughts about what those events might look like in that time frame. Farnborough 2030, it might seem for some of you a long time away. In the world of aerospace, that is just tomorrow. And 2030, it's very unlikely that we will see major new programs, aeroplane programs flying. We may well have seen something launched, we may well see some mock-ups, simulations of new products, but it's very unlikely that we will actually see new big commercial aircraft flying. But what we will see, and what I think is hugely, hugely exciting, is some of the things happening around drones or uncrewed air systems, as they're called now. Some of the things happening about electric vertical takeoff and lift vehicles. Some of the things happening around some of the smaller aircraft with battery electric aircraft or hydrogen fuel cell aircraft. So I think the theme of Farnborough 2030 is going to be much more about what's been achieved at some of those smaller ends of a spectrum and a lot less around demonstrating and showing some of the new major commercial airplanes. But by the time we get to 2050, I think it will be significantly different. We will, at that point, see some radically new airplane types. We'll see some radically different fuel vectors being used. Hydrogen, I believe, will be playing a very, very prominent part by 2050. So when we go to a Farnborough air show in 2050, I would expect to be seeing aircraft that look very, very different to the aircraft that we're accustomed to today. We may see things like blended wing bodies, something that looks very different from the cigar tube and wing kind of aeroplane concept we see today. we may see aircraft with high aspect, very long long wings, high aspect ratio wings with trusses holding them together that will look quite different to what we've seen today. We may start to see some big evolutions around the space agenda and see some new products there. So I think by the time we get to 2050, the world will look very, very different. And I think if you then start to extrapolate beyond 2050, and what will Farnborough look like then? Well, I think we will be starting to move into a very different age, an age of space travel, an age of space tourism. Maybe Farnborough will not be held at Farnborough in dear old UK. Maybe the show will be held on the moon or held on Mars or something really far-fetched like that. So I think we're going to see things which are very, very different. If I come back to this year's air show, 2024, what for me were the kind of key messages that came out of 2024? Well, I think the tensions that exist in the world today, there was an inevitability in some regards that there was a bit more focus around defence products than perhaps we have seen. I have spent the last 10 years with the focus on air shows and have always been around civil technologies, commercial technologies. I saw a little bit more of a presentation around defence capabilities and technologies and an increased use of the language around dual use capability. But that's not really where I want to focus on. For me, there were two really strong themes that came out of Farnborough this year. One was the whole theme around sustainability and the environmental challenges. And the second was the whole theme around digital transformation. I think there are some really big opportunities in both those regards. The sustainability and environmental challenge is probably the biggest challenge the aerospace industry has faced in the last 30, 40 years. I do think, like every challenge, however, there are opportunities that will come with that challenge. And for me, I'm really excited about the opportunities that come with the sustainability and the aviation challenge. If I think again of 2030, I would imagine that on large aircraft, the big thing we'll be hearing talking about is something called sustainable aviation fuels. They're fuels that are produced, developed in a very net zero carbon friendly sense. They are drop-in fuels. It means that today's aeroplanes will be able to fly much more environmentally friendly. There are a set of targets, 2050 targets, that the whole world, the whole aviation industry, the aircraft manufacturers, the airlines, the airports have all agreed to 2050 net zero goals. So I would expect from a sustainability point of view, from a large airplane point of view, what we'll be hearing about and seeing about is a lot more around sustainable aviation fuels. And candidly, the big challenge about sustainable aviation fuels is not about the airplane itself. It's about the production, it's about the financing of facilities to produce enough sustainable aviation fuel to meet the requirements of airlines around the world. The nature of a flight is that you fly from usually one country to another country. There's no point one country solving that challenge if on the other side of the planet we're not also doing the same thing. So this is a global problem of financing and producing enough sustainable aviation fuel to meet the needs of the future. I said I think there'll be a lot around drones, a lot around eVTOL, a lot around low carbon or zero carbon solutions. If I think about drones, I think 2030 will be the age where drones really come of age. You can probably remember 2018. There was a speck in the sky over Gatwick. It shut the Gatwick airport for the best part of 3 days over the busiest travel period of the Christmas period. Drones were persona non grata in the eyes of the public. But I think what COVID demonstrated was that the value of drones to our society can be huge. There is studies that have been done that show But it's of the order of a £45 billion economic opportunity just here in the UK associated with the use of drones. I can think of the use of drones in a surveillance sense. Anytime you need to send a helicopter up, well, imagine if you could send a low-cost drone up rather than a helicopter, using it for police, accident investigation, traffic monitoring, surveillance of flooding or crisis scenes. The use of drones for transporting organs was trials during the COVID crisis, the delivery of medicines to remote parts of the UK. So I think drones are going to come of age. And I think by the time we get to 2030, we could be seeing of the order of 900,000 drones in our sky. And the big challenge there is how we introduce drones into society in a way that's acceptable to society and safe in an airworthiness sense. So drones, I think, will play a very, very big part in a 2030 scenario. The eVTOL, which is electric vertical takeoff and lift solutions, which I think can provide urban transport mobility solutions for people. There's a lot of development going on now. If you wind the clock back even 2-3 years ago, it was an entrepreneur's dream. There were about 150 companies, I think, at one point, all developing new eVTOL-type solutions. Well, the reality of the marketplace, the reality of financing those, actually, you can now count the number of eVTOL manufacturers, certainly on the fingers of both hands. The pathway to the introduction of eVTOLs is now quite well established, and I would expect by probably 2026 we will see electric vertical takeoff and landing aircraft in our cities on demonstration flights, and by maybe 2028 it being a fairly routine to use an eVTOL from a taxi service point of view, a flying point of view. They will all be piloted. By 2030, we might see demonstrations of our first pilotless eVTOL aircraft. But I would anticipate maybe Farnborough 2030, people will be using eVTOLs to go from London into the Farnborough Airshow. It will be an operational kind of aspect. I think net zero and zero carbon solutions are much more likely to happen at the smaller aircraft level. And there's some huge developments going on around battery electric aircraft. I'm a great believer in hydrogen fuel cell as the power vector for small aircraft. And I would expect by 26, 27, we will start to see the routine use of hydrogen fuel cell on small aircraft, things like island hopping, intercity transport. That is not going to solve the net zero problems, challenges of the world, but it will be done in a zero carbon way, and it will help people to develop the skills, the capability to design and develop net zero solutions. It will help provide the pathways from a regulatory point of view that will help pave the way for much bigger net zero carbon solutions as we move forward. So I think we will see significant developments in those areas over the next few years. I think on the space side of things as well, we will start to see from an entrepreneurial point of view, huge, huge opportunities in terms of lowering the entry barriers for people to get into space and do some really interesting things, the new space economy as it's described. So that's how I see things developing through to 2030. I think the other thing that came through was digital and the transformation potential of using digital, applied artificial intelligence, both in the way we design aeroplanes, maintain aeroplanes, integrate aeroplanes into modern airspace management. But all of that's going to require a significant upskilling of our workforce. And I think that will be a major theme for academia, for schools, colleges, working with business to help upskill the members of the workforce to take advantage of these new digital tools. There was a really interesting piece at Farnborough, which was a front page of the Aerospace magazine, which described the top 10 careers that don't exist today but will exist within the next 10 years. Things like cryogenics engineers, things like additive manufacturing engineers, things like space domain awareness engineers. So again, a key message that came out of me from Farnborough was that not only are we reshaping the products, not only are we reshaping the processes of how we do things, but we are developing new careers, and it's for people like you, people with ideas, that will be part of that new community. So from my perspective, I came back from Farnborough hugely motivated, inspired about the future. There was that bit in the past that had inspired me, but I think what Farnborough did for me was sow the seeds for inspiration and new ideas for the next generation of engineers. So I left Farnborough incredibly motivated, inspired, and very confident about the future. Thank you for listening. My name's Iain Gray. Thank you.